How do I turn it on? I don't hear it. I don't think it's on.
Well, I can't hear you out there.
Yeah, that's the projector. Where's Dave Finchie? Jim Lang. Good morning. Welcome to the 1989 Current Issues in Nutrition Conference, originating from the Sheman Building at Iowa State University. We are pleased to have you join us, either live in our audience here at Sheman or at the downlink sites throughout Iowa and the United States. I am Laura Cook, a faculty member in the Food and Nutrition Department at Iowa State University and conference chair. As conference chair, I have worked with a group of volunteers who helped plan the conference for over a year. I would especially like to thank these people. Doreen Chamberlain and Dr. George Montgomery represent the healthcare providers in this area. Deborah Hassebrock is a representative of the Iowa Dietetic Association. Jackie McCann from the Iowa Attorney General's Office and Barbara Martin of the Iowa Department of Public Health come to us from Des Moines and act as representatives of state agencies. Ruth Houston is an officer in the Iowa Council Against Health and Nutrition Fraud, and Jackie Runyon and Rick Sharp, both faculty members at Iowa State University, are representing the Nutritional Science Council of the university. The efforts of the Planning Committee were implemented through the work of the staff of the Office of Continuing Education. We want to thank them for their outstanding work with Miriam Simmons as the manager of conference services. We also appreciate the expertise of the staff of WOI-TV, without whom there would be no picture on your screens. A conference like this relies heavily on the financial support of organizations who share our interest in health and nutrition. The Iowa Department of the Iowa State University Extension, the Nutritional Sciences Council of Iowa State, were major contributors to this program. Other organizations who contributed to make this program a success were the Iowa Dietetic Association, Mead Johnson Enteral Nutritionals, Iowa Beef Industry Council, the National Oats Company, the Iowa Pork Producers, Protein Technologies International, a subsidiary of Ralston Purina, the Iowa Attorney General's Office, the Dairy Council of Iowa, and the Iowa Council Against Health and Nutrition Fraud. There are conference participants at 14 downlink sites in Iowa and at another 14 sites from New Jersey to California. We welcome all of you. We look forward to questions from our audiences at all sites. Microphones are set up here in Sheman Auditorium, and there is an 800 number for questions from satellite sites. This number will appear on your screen as the conference proceeds. I will give it once, but it will be repeated. It is 800-747-5505. Many of you are receiving continuing or professional education credits based on your conference attendance. The appropriate sign-up sheets for those credits will be available after the conference evaluation near the registration desk here at Sheman, or from your downlink coordinator. Now I would like to begin our conference, Information, Misinformation on Nutrition and Health Issues, by introducing Marilyn Stevenson, a native Iowan and an ISU graduate. Mrs. Stevenson is with the FDA and assistant to the Director, Office of Nutrition and Food Sciences, with Food Safety and Applied Nutrition. She wrote the chapter on dietary fads and frauds, which appeared in the Surgeon General's Report on Nutrition and Health in 1988. This chapter addressed the economic and health consequences of fraud and the role of public and private agencies in exposing fraud and regulating health claims. I am very pleased to introduce Mrs. Stevenson. She tells me that she's now busy drafting a portion of the National Nutritional Objectives for the year 2000, a report that will be available for public review about June 1st, and information will be in the Federal Register concerning how the public can answer or have input for this report. Mrs. Stevenson will discuss the very timely issue of how nutrition fraud costs the elderly more than money. Mrs. Stevenson.
Good morning. It's always a pleasure to return to Iowa, and it's especially enjoyable to be back on the campus here at Iowa State University. I'm always proud to say that I'm an Iowa State graduate. My subject for today, nutrition fraud, is a far from new and a long continuing problem. Food fetishes, often related to medical cures, are ages old, but the advances made in nutrition science during this century have provided new and fertile grounds for false promotions. This form of nutrition fraud was aptly described by the then commissioner of FDA 30 years ago when he said, "In the wake of scientific advances, there often follows a host of persons who misinterpret them and exploit them for private gain." That has been true in the field of nutrition. The nutritionist studies the long-range benefits to the public health from new scientific findings, withholds premature endorsement, and has confidence that future research holds great promise. The promoter hastens to cash in before all of the facts are known. The same description certainly applies today, with the chief distinctions lying in the increased sophistication of some promotions, the rapidity with which they are communicated, and the mass audiences that they now easily reach. Today I'm going to discuss some of the most prevalent nutrition frauds, especially those that are promoted to the elderly, some of the current strategies underway to combat and contain health fraud, and some sources of reliable information that are available to help you in responding to fraudulent promotions. Let's start with a historical perspective by looking back two decades to the 1969 White House Conference on Food, Nutrition, and Health. That landmark conference highlighted numerous major food and nutrition concerns, and it set the stage subsequently for many of the food and nutrition initiatives during the past 20 years. Its recommendations, for example, provided the incentive for nutrition labeling and several other food labeling activities undertaken by the FDA in the 1970s. One special area of concern was the extent of public deception and misinformation about nutrition. Conference report noted that no other area of the national health probably is as abused by deception and misinformation as nutrition. Many travesties cheat the public of enormous sums of money and of good health as well. Yet the American people falsely believe they are well protected, both by the government and by the ethics of commerce. Among the recommendations made to improve this situation were better coordination between the enforcement agencies, more informed consumers, and new methods of food labeling. Some improvements have occurred in these areas, but we certainly need to strive to improve our record, especially the odds that consumers are better able to recognize nutrition fraud and protect themselves against it. Billions of dollars are still being spent today on worthless products and services. National figures on fraud only very imprecisely estimate the extent of fraud that occurs in this country. The Select Committee on Aging of the House of Representatives a few years ago stated that the price for the promotion and sale of useless remedies in this country exceeds $10 billion a year. But since then, others have escalated the cost to as high as $40 billion or more dollars a year. These promotions don't do anything for health and sometimes may be harmful, but they certainly can and do deplete the pocketbooks of many innocent victims. The good news is that there is today renewed cooperation among the many sectors which act against and educate the public about health fraud. And as exemplified by this meeting today, increased efforts are being made to reach out and inform the public about how to protect themselves against nutrition and other health fraud. These efforts must continue and be expanded in order to decrease the incidence of health fraud in this country. A disproportionately large amount of this fraud and quackery falls on our older citizens. Testimony before the Senate Special Committee on Aging in 1983 noted that the elderly were prime targets for consumer and economic frauds and were being systematically targeted and bilked. Senator John Glenn said that a committee survey had found that the elderly accounted for more than 30% of the fraud victims in this country. And he also stated that when they are victimized, the elderly suffer disproportionate losses and are slower to recover in financial, physical, and mental terms. Thus, the elderly have much more than money to lose if they are defrauded. And this already large target population grows by the decades. Quackery and medically related health fraud, such as phony arthritis and cancer cures, are the single most prevalent and damaging form of consumer fraud directed at the elderly. Nutrition scams, ranging from some very serious nutritional therapies for the cure of cancer to magical cures for impotency and baldness, often figure prominently in the schemes that are promoted. The Surgeon General's report in 1988 stated that running counter to and sometimes capitalizing on legitimate gains in scientific understanding of the relationships between diet and health, food fadism and nutrition fraud are increasingly prevalent in the United States. Although most of the adverse consequences of this trend are economic, fraud can have significant health consequences to individuals as a result of direct toxicity and also from the failure to seek the appropriate medical care or to engage in genuinely healthful dietary practices. The report stated that cooperative educational efforts by government, health professionals, and the private sector, including the news media, are needed to expose emerging fads and frauds before they become widely accepted by the public. The Surgeon General noted further that special efforts should be directed toward older persons because they are the target of so much nutrition fraud. Elderly persons with chronic diseases such as cancer, heart disease, and arthritis, and those who have relatives or friends with these conditions may be especially susceptible to nutrition frauds. Government enforcement actions against fraud, which are essential, are vested in all levels of government. At the federal level, the FDA has major enforcement responsibilities against health fraud and has long-term experience in combating fraudulent promotions. In light of the increased concern about some widespread and serious health fraud, the agency's action plans recently have highlighted the improvement of both its enforcement processes and public information activities. Especially greater emphasis has been placed on the coordination of FDA's fraud-fighting efforts with those of other government and private organizations, including helping with the development of a national coalition to network, to share information, and to work cooperatively in informing the public about the hazards that health fraud can involve. One method used to help build coalitions is the organization of conferences, which bring together many constituencies, all levels of government, law enforcement agencies, health professionals, consumer organizations, the media, and others, to provide practical guidance and to facilitate networking. Three national conferences have been held, with the latest national conference just last week in Puerto Rico. That conference is intended to serve as a prototype for the Hispanic community. And many regional conferences have been held in cities nationwide. For an overview of the current status of health fraud, we're going to look now at a tape that was made at the last national conference in Kansas City.
The toxins are coming out of you, and so you're being healed. The worse you feel, the better you're getting. And people actually believe that.
And that belief can cost them their lives, especially if they're suffering from a life-endangering disease like cancer or AIDS.
Now, I'm not talking about minor league scams like copper braces to prevent arthritis. I'm talking about the major league evil.
That major league evil is AIDS fraud. Like cancer before it, AIDS is a quackstream come true. Fertile ground for persuading the public there's hope in most anything.
The supplements, the diet, everything has gone together very well, and I'm doing fine now. I've dropped the chemo, and I have no intention of going back for their treatments anymore.
This is an example of just how brazen AIDS quacks have become. Using a television testimonial from a so-called AIDS patient to give credibility to their bogus treatments.
Quackery takes its cues from developments in the world of knowledge, which means that that's precisely what they're going to do. They're going to talk about enhancing your immune system because of the work that's going on in the immune system.
There are at least 20 companies that are marketing products that they claim will strengthen the immune system. Here's an example. This is a product that says, imagine being able to improve your odds in today's immune crisis.
Like most quackery, AIDS fraud mixes science with medical mumbo-jumbo, like references to bottled T cells.
Some of the things that we're seeing people do who think they have AIDS is starting to take injections of pond scum at $200 an injection. We've seen them inject themselves with byproducts of their own urine as a immuno-booster.
People desperately want to have some mystical cure for AIDS because they're so terrified of it. It has replaced cancer as one of the most feared diseases in our society.
Every cancer scam, almost without exception, has become an AIDS scam.
Incurable diseases, as long as they exist, undoubtedly so will health fraud. But it can be contained. Experts say the key to combating it lies in grassroots efforts. While enforcement is important on the state and federal levels, they say only when people work together within their own communities, building coalitions on the local level, can health fraud effectively be controlled.
Several important points about current fraud are apparent from these interviews. First, we need to be aware that anyone bent on fraud today can reach many potential victims through the modern communication technologies. Quacks don't need to rely on person-to-person and door-to-door operations anymore as they used to. More and more sophisticated marketing is utilized, which employs an arsenal of mass communications, 800 telephone lines, computerized calling lists, slick advertising through the various media, and direct delivery of a product to the consumer, which circumvents the postal service or other government intervention. The effects of these technologies were addressed in congressional hearings several years ago by the Attorney General of Maine. He related mass communication of fraud to the need in his state to spend increasing time and resources on the problem of elderly fraud. He stated that the most effective way to frustrate modern mass media techniques is to educate American citizens on the most common frauds being aimed at them, with special efforts to educate the elderly. A second point from the conference is that the same type of human appeal is still being used and apparently works just as well as that which has always enabled fraud. That's the appeal to people's emotions, making them feel afraid or guilty, or that they're missing out on some great new breakthrough, or promising them something magical in the way of prevention, cure, or treatment. Since the appeal is usually emotional, that's why higher education doesn't insure a person against health fraud. One of the authorities at the Kansas City Conference stated that more educated people are more likely to use unorthodox therapies, and that's a statement which is supported by a recent FDA study. The National Conference in Kansas City also highlighted the fact that a major evil occurring today is that quackery has very agilely stepped into the AIDS arena. We heard this repeated last week at the Puerto Rico Conference. One authority at that Kansas City conference noted that every cancer scam has become an AIDS scam, a statement again reiterated in San Juan. Such fraud is directed not only to the people already diagnosed with the disease, but also to those who are concerned about coming down with it. The FDA, of course, is aware of this problem and has a major program to address it. Any unapproved AIDS product that it becomes aware of and that is under the agency's jurisdiction is investigated aggressively. Misleading information about AIDS by fraudulent promoters and practitioners is of special concern because it undermines legitimate public health education about the disease and may hasten its spread, as well as hurting people financially. Nutrition scams, as you saw on the tape, are prominent in false promotions about AIDS. And you're probably already aware of the multiple unproven health and nutrition regimens for this disease. These include various potions and so-called supplements popularly advertised and nebulously promoted as a means of strengthening the immune system. Dr. Dwyer, who will be speaking later today, recently has described in Nutrition Today the many unproven nutritional therapies for AIDS. These prominently include the so-called immunological therapies of megadoses of certain vitamins and minerals, particularly vitamin E, selenium, and zinc. Various other diets and regimens are also equally unproven as successful in treating AIDS. Unproven nutritional therapies already promoted for one or more diseases or conditions are often recycled and promoted opportunistically as remedies for other additional health conditions. Such is the case with several other unproven therapies for AIDS, including the use of macrobiotic diets. This slide is taken from an article in one of the current trade journals. And as you'll see there, AIDS, the macrobiotics is promoted as for treatment of not only AIDS, but obesity, hypoglycemia, cancer, herpes, and additional diseases. Other strange types of products are also advertised. And you'll see the line down below says, you can only live as long as you can defend yourself. Take this product every day, just in case. These are all among the many methods discredited as unproven for cancer management. Laetrol, herbals, many other strange potions and regimens that are being promoted now for AIDS. Unproven therapies remain unproven remedies for any disease or condition. But unfortunately, the public often is not aware of this fact. Dr. Dwyer and her co-authors at Tufts University have pointed out that the appropriate nutritional support for AIDS patients is variable, depending on the pre-existing nutritional status of the patient before the onset of AIDS, as well as the diseases that the immunodeficiency diseases cause. The nutritional therapy, therefore, must be appropriately individualized to the patient. Claims for boosting immune power aren't directed solely at the AIDS population, however. The elderly in particular may be targeted for this promotion as a promise for improving their general protection against illnesses. Considerable scientific evidence documents an age-related decline in immune competence, but it's uncertain how much of this decline might be related to nutritional deficiency. Like the rest of the body, the immune system needs adequate supplies of essential nutrients. Severely malnourished people may get sick more easily, and their immunity may be improved by increasing nutrients to adequate levels. However, megadoses of nutrients have not been proven beneficial in improving the immune response in healthy individuals, and some research indicates that such treatment may suppress some immune responses. Every disease that afflicts the elderly attracts a share of nutrition and other health fraud. Because arthritis occurs so commonly in many middle-aged and older people, many ineffective diets, nutrition combinations, and other unproven remedies have been spawned for this disease. Special diets, special so-called food supplements, such as alfalfa tablets, and vitamins and minerals, including some substances that are falsely represented as essential nutrients, are among the various nutrition remedies that are touted as useful in the prevention and control of arthritis. However, other than the control of body weight to ease pressure on the joints, scientific evidence has not linked diet with the diseases of arthritis except for gout. Fraudulent cancer remedies, such as those mentioned in relation to AIDS, have long been perpetuated, and they are the most cruel hoaxes, because the delay of prompt and effective treatment of some cancers is almost always fatal. Tragically, many cases have been documented where ineffectual nutrition therapies were responsible for such delays. Many of these phony treatments occur in clinics outside the country, but some are also actively promoted within our own borders. Fortunately, for most of the major diseases, cancer, heart disease, arthritis, diabetes, osteoporosis, there are public and private organizations which can provide sound information and advice to consumers. The American Cancer Society, for example, collects information about unproven methods of cancer management and distributes material on them. And the Arthritis Foundation similarly provides sound information about that disease and is active in informing the public. Other private organizations, such as the American Association of Retired Persons, publish sound health information for their members. And the National Council Against Health Fraud provides continuing update to its members about current fraud. The information centers for several of the National Institutes of Health, which are located in Bethesda, Maryland, also have information about different diseases. These include the Institute on Aging, the Cancer Institute, the Heart, Lung, and Blood Institute, the Institute of Diabetes and Digestive Disease and Kidney Disease, and the Institute of Arthritis and Musculoskeletal and Skin Diseases. Information and second opinion from these organizations may provide positive support for an individual and help persuade against the use of fraudulent diet disease promotions. The presence of illness isn't the only factor that makes older people receptive to false health promotions. The fear of developing disease, the fear of aging itself, and the natural desire to remain fit and healthy also are inviting factors. Pinpointing reliable sources of information for these types of promotions may be more difficult than for the chronic diseases. FDA field offices often have information, or they can help you to locate sound information on these questions, and I'll mention more about these resources later. A contributing factor to some nutrition fraud is the frequent media reporting nowadays of the latest research from current scientific journals. Often the reported research still represents hypothesis, but promoters are quick to capitalize on such information For example, life extension schemes, such as those that advise fasting or very low calorie intakes, may have a tenuous link to some inconclusive research on the aging process. However, the 1988 Surgeon General's report on nutrition and health that I referred to earlier quite clearly indicates that the basic causes of aging currently remain research theories. Based on what is still preliminary research, large amounts of antioxidant supplements, including the vitamins E, C, and A, and the enzyme superoxide dismutase, have been purported to help prevent aging. Not only is there insufficient evidence concerning the effects of antioxidants on aging, but taking large amounts of certain nutrients, for example, vitamins A and D, may be hazardous for the elderly. The claims made for different enzyme supplements are equally unsubstantiated. Many enzymes that are normally present in the body, such as superoxide dismutase, are promoted as food supplements today. However, when enzymes are taken orally and become digested, they don't retain their usual properties of enzymes and thus are ineffectual for the purposes for which they are promoted. Similarly, the theory that aging results from damaged DNA has encouraged the promotion of supplements containing DNA, RNA, or both. But there's no scientific evidence that indicates ingestion of either of them can counteract the aging process. These substances, like superoxide dismutase, are digested if taken. In addition, superoxide dismutase has not been proven for food consumption as a food additive, and some of these products have been seized by FDA on that basis. The most reliable information for the elderly comes from the National Institute on Aging, which offers a number of sensible suggestions for improving the chances of staying healthy and living a longer time. These include: don't smoke, eat a balanced diet and maintain your desirable weight, have regular health checkups and see a doctor when you detect a problem, stay involved with family and friends, allow time for rest and relaxation, get enough sleep, and that amount varies from individual to individual. Stay active through work, recreation, and community activities. Drink alcoholic beverages in moderation, if at all, and don't drive after drinking. Use your seat belts and avoid overexposure to sun and cold. And practice good safety habits to guard against fire, falls, and other accidents. This practical advice can be offered to any of us, and that suggests that there's no real difference for the elderly in terms of maintaining health than from the rest of the population. The extent of gullibility of many consumers is reflected in a recent FDA study on the use of questionable treatments. The 1987 study on 15 different treatment areas reported that more than a quarter of Americans use questionable health care treatments. And that's probably an underestimate because not all of the questionable areas were examined. For example, weight loss treatments were not included, and we know that those are very popular. Fortunately, only a very small percentage of those reporting had ever used a questionable product that caused them any harm. The financial cost on the individual level was relatively small. Half reported spending less than $25 in the previous year, although that too may have been an underestimate. As noted earlier, the use of questionable treatments was not associated with education or income level. Notably, the users of questionable products reported that they had never complained to anyone about their products. Just why is it that the public is persuaded, apparently easily, by varied nutrition and other health fraud promotions? Certainly the reasons are many. But one contributing factor may be the false belief that what is told to people must be true or it wouldn't be allowed by the government. The fact is that in the United States, governments at all levels are limited in what they can do about fraudulent practices by an obligation to observe the constitutional rights of free speech and free press. Published nutrition promotions, whether scientifically supported or not, are guaranteed the same First Amendment protection as other types of information. The right to freely say, write, or publish anything one chooses is protected, as long as it's done without intentional malice and does not break any laws relevant to labeling or advertising. For example, books that are published about that promise how to live longer, or one common promotion now, the use of hydrogen peroxide for the treatment of AIDS and many other diseases, fall under the constitutional protection. Freedom of speech is a precious and cherished heritage, but the public needs to be made aware of what protection the government can and does provide in such areas, and where education is the consumer's best protection. At the federal level, three agencies primarily are responsible for enforcement against fraud: the Food and Drug Administration, the Federal Trade Commission, and the U.S. Postal Service. Each of these agencies has different legal authorities and their systems for monitoring fraud. However, they do actively cooperate with each other. For example, the FDA not infrequently provides nutrition expertise to the other agencies. Recently, they've worked together in the National Health Fraud Conferences, and they have produced a joint publication on quackery. And I'll mention a little about the other two agencies before talking about FDA's authorities and programs. The Federal Trade Commission's authority against fraud relates primarily to false advertising. The agency monitors advertising in various print media, on the radio, and in television to identify targets for commission action. False advertising also is identified through consumer complaints and by ongoing contacts with other state and federal officials and private groups. Purchases through the mail are particularly vulnerable to fraudulent inducements because of their inability to examine the product before payment is made. Congress, therefore, many years ago empowered the U.S. Postal Authority to protect the public from marketing schemes conducted by mail. Intentional fraudulent use of the mails is punishable by a fine and imprisonment, and misrepresentation of goods or services by promoters must be avoided. Additional protection was added through the Mail Order Consumer Protection Amendments of 1983. However, promoters today are finding new ways to circumvent these postal protections. Advertisements may be made, for example, during long television ads, or commercials that are disguised as talk shows or reporting programs. And then private parcel delivery services are used that are not under Postal Service jurisdiction. Many nutrition-related schemes are prosecuted under the mail fraud statute. These involve various cure-alls, instant weight reduction techniques, and a variety of substances falsely described as having the ability to cure diseases or disabilities. For example, the Postal Service was recently successful in ceasing one company's nationwide advertising of what was described as power-packed wonder pills that destroy stubborn fat forever. The pills were nothing more than vitamins, and the real secret to losing weight under the program was an unadvertised diet and exercise program that the purchasers of the pills were advised to follow. Such action by the Postal Department stops promotion by the individual company, and it may have a deterrent effect on others. But it doesn't guarantee that other companies won't continue making similar fraudulent promotions. This is very evident in looking at weight loss promotions in magazines, weekly tabloids, and other sources of information. The FDA, in conjunction with the Better Business Bureaus, has sent recommendations to the media for reviewing advertisements in efforts to sensitize the media to this problem. We obviously still have a long ways to go, but considerable information has been sent out to newspapers, radio stations, television stations, and so forth across the country in an effort to help them evaluate the kind of information that's in their advertisements. The Food, Drug, and Cosmetic Act prohibits the introduction into the market of any food, device, or cosmetic that is adulterated or misbranded. This authority doesn't explicitly address health fraud, but many of its general provisions enable the agency to take actions. These include the gathering of information about health fraud products and practices through inspections of manufacturing plants, the collection of samples and records of interstate shipments, and the gathering of evidence such as photographs and copies of labeling. Labeling includes not only the information that appears on the package, but any accompanying information. Only factual and non-misleading information is allowed in food labeling. Many fraud cases are based on misbranding charges resulting from false or misleading labeling of food products. Most false promotional claims, such as the anti-aging promotions mentioned earlier, therefore are not made on food labels. They appear instead in newsletters, books sold separately from the product, lectures, and other modes that are protected by constitutional rights. In addition to food labeling provisions, FDA has authority through its food additive process to control food products allowed on the market and to remove fraudulent products that are not recognized as safe for human consumption. The food products regulated by FDA do not have to receive pre-market approval, but all food components must be classified either as generally recognized as safe or have undergone the required process for a food additive. If one or more ingredients do not meet these requirements, the product is considered adulterated and is subject to regulatory action. FDA takes action against many products based on its food additive authority. Some products acted upon recently include evening oil of primrose, blackcurrant oil, linseed oil, superoxide dismutase, which I mentioned earlier, and a germanium compound. All of these were being promoted for various health reasons, but are unapproved food additives. In some cases, drug charges have also been used against these products. People are often surprised to learn that FDA does not give pre-marketing approval for all individual food products. Frequently, we have even health professionals calling us to ask whether a new diet or some other new product that's popularly sweeping their part of the country is approved by the FDA. The U.S. Department of Agriculture does have authority to require the pre-marketing approval of the labeling of meat and poultry products under its jurisdiction, but FDA does not have this authority. The agency can intervene when adulteration occurs, such as contamination or filth contained in a food product or an unapproved food additive, or when any safety issue is involved. And although it's occasionally claimed falsely, FDA does not give a stamp of approval for any food product. Many actions against food fraud are based on the drug provisions of the Food, Drug, and Cosmetic Act. Drugs are defined as articles intended for use in the diagnosis, cure, mitigation, treatment, or prevention of diseases in humans. Most fraudulent food products are classified as foods, but when a therapeutic claim is made, such as being useful in the treatment of a specific disease, the product is also considered to be a drug. The process for establishing drug efficacy is long and costly, and very few manufacturers elect to pursue the drug approval process for a food product. Drug products are required under the law to have first an approved new drug application that demonstrates both safety and efficiency for its intended uses, and second, adequate directions for its use. If a food product is classified as a drug and is considered by FDA to be ineffective for its claimed use, it would probably not have a new drug application and would be subject to regulatory action. For example, the agency recently sent regulatory letters to some companies concerning unsupported disease treatment claims for fish oil capsules and bee pollen products. The FDA uses a variety of strategies to monitor fraud, including the screening of advertisements in newspapers, magazines, and periodicals for suspected health fraud products. This is usually done by our field offices. Reports received by various offices from consumers, the media, and health professionals are also used to monitor programs for suspected fraudulent health-related products. The reports received on frauds are provided to the FDA district where the manufacturer of the product is located for investigation and possible regulatory action. The reports are also provided to the newly established FDA Health Fraud Coordinator's Office in Kansas City and to the health fraud staff in the Center for Drug Evaluation and Research for follow-up. However, our agency resources are limited and priority has to be assigned where the need is greatest. The highest priority for regulatory action is for products with gross violations that present life-threatening hazards to the public. For such serious violations, immediate enforcement action, that is, seizure or injunction, is usually appropriate. Within practical limitations, the product is removed from the marketplace, and the public is usually warned about the product. For example, an automatic detention is put on a product entering the United States if it contains an unsafe ingredient. The recent mass retention of Chilean grapes because of possible cyanide content exemplifies this priority. The next action level is products with health-threatening effects, in which case the agency tries to act quickly against the product. Also included would be products which do not in themselves pose a health hazard, but may affect a person's health by causing delay or denial of proper medical treatment, and products which are promoted for uses for which they are not effective. Removal of the product from the market in this case may be secondary to being sure that the product is not misused by or misrepresented to the public. Food products falsely represented for the treatment of serious diseases such as cancer are an example of products with this level of priority. The third level for action includes food products which involve economic fraud. These products don't pose a direct health hazard and little or no indirect hazard. Action is taken against these types of products when the agency's resources permit, and is most likely when the claims are blatantly false and misleading, and wide use of the product by consumers is likely. Unfortunately, economic frauds are so numerous that enforcement against all of them by FDA or the other federal agencies is not economically or practically feasible. Also, in many cases, state and local authorities and agencies may be in a position to take more immediate action on these types of fraud. I assume we'll hear more about these state and local actions later today. Fortunately or unfortunately, however you choose to regard it, many nutrition promotions represent primarily economic fraud. For example, anti-aging nutrition remedies, food supplements to increase sexual potency, and other unproven but comparatively harmless claims for food substances. Nutrition claims that are made on the label, such as high fiber or high protein content, or appear on pills, which contain only insignificant amounts of these substances, also represent economic fraud, and they do receive much agency attention if they are on the product's label. Our field offices in many cities nationwide serve as the agency's first line of action in health fraud, and public education about fraud is an important adjunct to their activities. Consumer affairs officers who are in many of these cities conduct consumer education programs concerning foods and other areas of FDA's authority, and they respond to many professional and consumer questions. Their programs help to inform the public about nutrition and other health fraud and the government's ability to protect consumers from misinformation. Their programs also provide guidance to consumers in recognizing fraud, evaluating product claims, making informed decisions, and registering complaints and concerns about fraudulent products. Our consumer affairs officers are valuable resources to health professionals. Since this program is being heard outside of Iowa, I've put down the address for obtaining the name and address of the consumer affairs officer in your area from our Rockville, Maryland address. The consumer affairs officers for Iowa, there are two of them, are Julia Hughley in our Kansas City office, and Mary Margaret Richardson, whose office is in St. Louis. Through the consumer affairs officers, you have a direct line of communication with the resources that are in our Center for Food Safety and Applied Nutrition in Washington. I'm going to suggest today, if we do not have time to answer all of your questions, or you have any questions in the future, that you channel your information through that you channel your information through Mary Margaret Richardson. The consumer affairs officers often are distributing information around the country to other consumer affairs officers who from the area in which the questions originate. So if you do that today, that'll give you a source in the future for having your questions answered. The FDA Consumer Magazine, which is a subscription publication, is another valuable information resource. The magazine has major articles on nutrition and other health fraud areas and provides summaries of recent court actions involving FDA's regulatory authority. For example, they've published articles which have described our program through the national meetings. They have had articles on fraud against the elderly. Many interesting articles in the nutrition area. The yearly rate now is quite reasonable. It's actually come down, which is one of the few things that I know of that's come down in the last 10 years, but it's $12 a year, and it can be ordered through the U.S. Government Printing Office. I mentioned earlier a publication on quackery that's been produced jointly by the FDA, Federal Trade Commission, and the U.S. Postal Service. It's available through I guess I don't have the address on that. I'll have to give you the address. It is available through the FDA Communications Affairs and Information, 5600 Fisher's Lane, Rockville, Maryland, 20857. Over 400,000 copies of this publication have been distributed to consumers by FDA. It's an extremely popular publication. It has many tips on recognizing fraud, which are useful to both health professionals and to consumers. The Rockville office also responds to many other consumer inquiries besides health fraud. In addition to federal resources, of course, you have your own state and local health departments, county medical societies, and consumer affairs offices, cooperative extension service, university nutrition departments, the dietetic associations who are helping to sponsor this today, and the Better Business Bureaus among the most valuable resources and reliable resources. No matter what the population is that we're talking about, the job of combating fraud is far too numerous, enormous, and complex for any single agency or organization to do by itself. An effective strategy requires the united efforts of all sectors down to the local level. In fact, as it was said in San Juan last week, effective action depends almost entirely upon local participation. Nutrition professionals have special responsibility and opportunities for helping to educate the public about fraudulent food and nutrition promotions. And we're seeing much more participation by nutrition professionals today. Members of the American Dietetic Association and various other professional organizations are actively responding to the need for these efforts. They can play a key role, especially in helping to expose and contain emerging health and nutrition frauds. I'll close by offering some of my own thoughts about why nutrition and other health fraud present such a continuing challenge in this country. One factor, I believe, relates to the heterogeneity of our population. As a melting pot for many cultures, the U.S. has become home to many false beliefs. People coming here often have used certain fraudulent items in their homelands, and not infrequently, they still seek them out here in this country. They may order such products from the old country, and they may introduce their lures and spread the word to others about the many qualities of these items. Their beliefs are usually sincere, but the claims are basically fraudulent. Plain old American ingenuity is another big factor contributing to health and other fraud. This twisted quotation from a famous con man stresses a truism about fraud in this country. You can't fool all of the people all the time, but someone is trying. It's a fact of life, and one that we can be sure of, that every day someone is thinking up new ways to fool the public or some special sector of the public. Very often that target is our elderly citizens. Whatever the origin or source, the many mobile faces of fraud will continue to present